Chapter 16. Burning the Jade Lute Specter. Jiang Ziya found the back garden a very pleasant place. Surrounded by high walls, it was planted with weeping willows on the left side and pine trees on the right. Opposite the peony pavilion was the hall for enjoying flowers. Flower beds lay near a swing. In the lotus pond, schools of goldfish swam to and fro, while under the arbor pairs of butterflies danced together. The garden looked like a fairyland, an ideal place to enjoy one's retirement. Jiang Ziya had never been in the garden before. Looking around for a long time, he asked Song Yiren, "Why don't you build a tower on this vacant space?"
"Why build a tower?
You've shown me great kindness, but I can give you only a little advice. According to geomancy, a tower here would guarantee that your family will produce 36 jade-belted ministers and numerous gold-belted officials. You're also familiar with geomancy." Song was surprised.
"I know just a little.
To tell you the truth, I've tried to build here several times, but every time it's been burnt down shortly afterwards.
I've lost interest.
I'll choose a lucky day, and you just take care of the construction. On the day when the beams are raised, you entertain the masons, carpenters, and other workers, and I'll stay here to deal with the evil spirits. Nothing serious will happen," Jiang Ziya assured him. Trusting him, Song Yiren chose an auspicious day on which he hired laborers and began the construction. At midnight on the day chosen to raise the beams, Song Yiren entertained the workmen in the front hall while Jiang Ziya sat quietly on watch in the peony pavilion. Before long, a fierce wind blew up. It was so violent that it sent clouds of sand and dust into the air and scattered stones and rocks over the ground. In the flickering light of a fire that broke out when the wind came up, Jiang Ziya saw five malignant spirits with faces of five colors, spitting thousands of fiery rays from between their bared fangs. The fire, magnified by the violent wind, became so fierce that it turned the earth red, destroying everything in its path. Seeing these evil spirits, Jiang Ziya drew his sword and left the pavilion. He waved his sword in the air, pointed at the spirits with the other hand, and then opened his palm. "Come down, you devils!" he shouted. A thunder crack shook the earth, knocking the spirits onto their knees before him. "Celestial Lord, we lower beasts didn't know of your honorable arrival and failed to meet you in time. We beg you to be merciful and spare our lives," they begged. "You wicked beasts. You've already burned down the tower here several times, yet your evil knows no end. Now you must all die for it." Jiang Ziya rebuked and moved forward, sword raised. The apparitions all kowtowed. "Celestial Lord, the way demands us to be compassionate at all times. We were once animals, but succeeded in becoming spirits. Should you punish us with death today because of our rash mistake, our years of cultivation will all have been in vain. We're sorry to have offended you and beg you to pardon us. If you wish to live, you must stop troubling the people here. You five animal spirits must take my order and go straight to Mount Qi. Wait for me there because I'll need you to move earth and clay sometime in the future. When you've accomplished meritorious acts, you'll naturally make spiritual progress along the proper path," Jiang Ziya instructed. The five spirits kowtowed before him, then set off for Mount Qi at once. All this time, Song Yiren was entertaining the masons and carpenters. In the front hall, but Madame Ma and Madame Sung had crept stealthily out to see what Jiang Ziya was doing. When they got to the back garden, they saw him talking into thin air. "Madame, listen." Jiang Ziya's talking to himself. He's never gotten anywhere in his life. How can a man who speaks a lot of mumbo jumbo have any hope of success in the future? Madame Ma exclaimed, greatly annoyed. She rushed up to Jiang. "Who are you talking to?
Oh, you women don't understand.
I was just subduing some evil spirits. You were just talking mumbo jumbo to yourself. Don't give me that rubbish about subduing apparitions. Even if I explained, you wouldn't understand," Jiang Ziya retorted.
Little do you know that I'm not only skilled at geomancy, but can predict the future by analyzing the yin and yang.
What?
You can do fortune-telling? Asked Madame Ma.
Yes, I'm an outstanding fortune-teller, but I've got no place to open a shop.
As they talked, Song Yi Rin came up.
Brother, did you see anything during that thunderstorm?
Jiang Ziya told him the whole story.
You're so well-versed in magic arts that your years of study were not spent in vain.
Song said, admiring him.
Since he can tell fortunes, it's a pity that no place can be found to open a fortune-teller's shop.
We should find a vacant house somewhere for him.
Madame Sun urged her husband.
That's no problem at all.
How many rooms do you need?
The busiest place in Zhaoge is the South Gate District.
I'll tell my servants to rent a house there and clean it up.
Song Yiren promised.
A few days later, the house in the South Gate District was chosen, cleaned, and set in order, and a couplet was pasted on the door.
On the left was written,
speaking only of the way,
while the right side read,
never uttering a word of falsehood.
Inside the house was posted a couplet in two long sentences.
On one side was written,
the iron mouth can predict all mortal fortunes and misfortunes.
And on the opposite side,
two crystal eyes observe the rise and decline of all the world.
A third couplet read,
inside the sleeves are the immense sky and earth.
Within the jug appear the eternal sun and moon.
When everything was ready, Jiang Ziya selected an auspicious day and opened his fortune-telling shop.
But 4 or 5 months slipped by, and not a single customer came to have his fortune told.
One day, a woodcutter named Liu Qian came to the south gate, carrying a shoulder pole laden with firewood.
When he caught sight of the fortune-teller's shop, he put his load on the ground, read the couplet on the door, and then entered the house.
He found Jiang Ziya taking a nap, his head resting on the desk.
Liu Qian banged on the desk, awakening Jiang Ziya with a start.
Looking up, Jiang Ziya found a man 15 feet tall glaring at him fiercely.
Do you want me to make a divination by diagrams, or just tell your fortune by the date of your birth?
What's your honorable name, sir?
Liu Qian asked.
My name's Jiang Shan. I'm called Jiang Ziya, or Fei Xiong.
Would you tell me what inside the sleeves are the immense sky and earth?
Within the jug appear the eternal sun and moon means.
Liu Qian asked.
The first sentence means that I'm so profound in my learning that I know both the past and the future, and understand all phenomena in the world.
The second means that I'm in possession of the art of living eternally.
You brag too much.
Since you know both the past and the future, your prediction should be extremely accurate.
Make a divination for me.
If it's accurate, I'll give you 20 coppers for your service, but if it's not, I'll give you the taste of my fists and close down your shop in the bargain.
Liu Qian said fiercely.
I've been idle for the last few months, and now that I finally have a customer, he turns out to be a rogue.
Jiang Ziya thought to himself and said,
pick up one of the divining slips from the plate and let me work it out for you.
Liu Qian picked out one and handed it to Jiang Ziya.
Jiang looked at it.
My prediction will come true if you do just as I tell you.
I'll write 3 sentences on a sheet of paper, and you may go on your way, but you must make sure to follow their directions.
Liu Qian took the sheet of paper from Jiang Ziya and found the following instructions.
Go straight south. You will find an old man under the willow trees.
You will be given 120 coppers, 4 dishes of refreshments, and 2 bowls of wine.
How can your prediction possibly come true?
Said Liu Qian scornfully.
I've been selling firewood for over 20 years, but never once have I been given refreshments and wine.
You're way off the mark.
You just go ahead.
I guarantee it's accurate.
Jiang Ziya insisted.
Liu Qian shouldered his load of firewood and walked directly south.
Sure enough, he soon came upon an old man standing in the shade of some willow trees.
Woodcutter, come here a moment.
The man shouted to him.
Good heavens! Thought Liu Qian.
It's just as he said.
How much do you want for your firewood?
the old man asked. Intending to prevent Jiang Ziya's prediction from coming true, Liu Qian answered. I'll sell it for 100 coppers. The old man looked the firewood over and said. It's good firewood, well dried, and tied in large bundles. All right, I'll take it for 100 coppers. Liu Qian helped the old man take the firewood inside, and being of a tidy nature, swept the ground clean. Then, he waited patiently for his money. When the old man came out to pay him, he saw the ground already swept.
Brother, it's my son's wedding today. I'm so glad to have met a good fellow like you and got such excellent firewood. He said and went back inside.
Moments later, a young servant came out with a tray, on which were four dishes of refreshment, a pot of wine, and a bowl. My master offers you some refreshment. Please help yourself. Liu Qian gasped in astonishment. Mr. Jiang must be a celestial being. But I'll play a trick on him. I'll fill the first bowl right up to the brim so that there'll not be wine left to fill up the second. That way his prediction will be rendered untrue. He thought. He filled the bowl with wine and drank it, then filled it up again. To his surprise, the wine filled the bowl exactly to the brim. As he was finishing off the second bowl, the old man came out again carrying two strings of coins. Here's the money for the firewood. The old man said, giving him the first string, then added. As it's my son's wedding day today, here's a celebratory tip of 20 coppers to buy wine with. Shouldering the empty baskets, Liu Qian rushed straight back to the fortune teller's shop, exclaiming. A celestial being in Zhaoge.